I'm GSB 2005, and after 10 years nearly graduation, I still stay with the same company for one reason. They allow me to partially run my China business by investing into exciting startups here. Today you will see one of the examples. I really absorb energy from the entrepreneurs I interact every day on a daily basis, and we will have founder and CEO Hua Lu for MOGIO coming on the stage to join me together with So. We used to be the co-founder for London Club. Now he's running his rather exciting China business, dianrong.com. Let's welcome him as well. Please take a seat. So I know it's really late in the afternoon. The energy level cannot be as high as in the beginning, so we want to talk about something rather interesting. It's about money. We're celebrating the 20 years anniversary of internet inception in China. I guess we used the first decade to really build a user base, really to copy all the successful models from the US. And the second decade, we start to see the real, tangible, significant monetization coming in. Monetization has to be built upon really effective funding for the small businesses, especially in a rather transparent platform, and also has to be empowered by reliable payment solutions. So I will start our session by having the two entrepreneurs to introduce their business model here. Lu had experience working with PayPal, both in Silicon Valley, Hong Kong, and Shanghai for over 10 years. And so had his experience founding Lending Club, the leading P2P lending institution in the US. I would like to hear from you guys. Are you doing the similar things in China or building something even better? Maybe we'll let So start first.
So thank you, Annabelle. Thank you for the invitation. Glad to be here. That is true. There were a lot of businesses that were started on the internet, but they had some challenges, and monetization comes later. So in my opinion, businesses that are well-priced in the sense that when the consumer buys a product, whether it's an e-commerce site or whether it's a financial service, if the product is well-priced, he will have a chance to compare the deal that he got online versus what he can get offline. And that's what brings value. So if we're talking about technology, if we're talking about the internet, the point is to reduce prices. In our case, it's reducing interest rates on the borrower side and keeping the yield higher for the lender. And I think in the US, we have successfully done that. And that's why monetization for us is fairly easy. In China, the opportunity is even bigger because the interest rates that people are paying are very high compared to what people get if they deposit their money in the bank. So that makes a huge opportunity for companies like us.
Is that the arbitrage opportunity?
Well, you can look at it in different ways. We choose to look at it from creating an infrastructure that will create an efficient market. I will describe here when I go through the slides how we are able to do that.
Yeah,
so anytime you build technology, the first question you have to ask, what is the purpose of your technology? Like for example, cars, they help us in making distances smaller, and medical technology makes us live longer. So for us, the purpose is to fight against frozen capital. What does that mean? Any society, whether the US or China, you have people with money. But at the same time, you have people that need that capital. And there are multiple reasons why somebody with money is not going to be comfortable lending it to somebody that needs it. It's easy to lend money. It's very hard to get back. What we created is a system or a platform or a mechanism to make that happen in a safe way, in a way that guarantees to what is possible returns. So to us, we look at that as a logistics problem. We don't look at it as a financial problem. So what do I mean by that? So if you look here, if you are a traditional loan company, and by traditional, I put banks in that category as well, you have to pay all these things to operate. So one of them is the cost of capital, origination and servicing, compliance. And the biggest one is customer acquisition. So there is a reason why customer acquisition in financial industry is very high, because the prices are also very high. But if you use technology and if you use a new business model, you can reduce all of that cost and you can keep a good healthy portion that actually you can give back to your borrowers and to your lenders, and therefore you have created a more efficient market. So it's easy said than done, but in general, if you have two sides, you have lenders on one side and you have borrowers on one side, you can choose to solve this problem in two ways. First, you can pay for deposits, all right? And then you turn around and you look for borrowers. And your revenue model is based on the difference. So of course, you want to pay lower interest rate and you want to charge higher interest rate. That's how you make more money. Well, we'll call this a game of high return, high risk, because you're actually taking the risk for money that you borrowed from others. What we did is to create a direct link between borrowers and lenders, just like in the stock market. Apple, Microsoft, or Tencent does not borrow money from you. You invest in them. It's very different. So if the borrower is paying 20%, the lender took a risk with him, he should get all the 20%, should not be getting 8%. If the market is good today, like it is in China, and the rates are still healthy, yes, these companies are making money. But when it turns around the corner and default goes up, which is something normal, markets go up and down, this is very dangerous. So we choose to go in this direction to be completely transparent. So we look at the problem just like a market, and we created something similar to the NASDAQ of loans. What does that mean? All these people in blue are lenders. Again, I go back to the original statement. We need to convince these people to lend their money. In order for us to convince them to lend their money, we have to offer them the following. So you can lend as little as 100 RMB. I mean, if you go to a bank and tell them start lending small amounts, they look at the cost and they say, no, I'd rather lend 100 million or 200 million and build a bridge than wasting time with like a small business. It's too much operation, too much hassle. So we were able to break down loans into small fractions so you, as an individual, can invest in them directly. So that's number one. If you invest and you change your mind, you want to exit, you can put it in our market and you can sell it to another person. So it's high liquidity, which is very important. It's a market, and markets are good because you can control prices and you can control the rules of the market. So whether you're a government, whether you are a big company, and you can actually affect how this market functions. But if you just leave it open, it's hard to control it. And for us, just like any market, the IPO process is when we take a borrower, we underwrite him, and we use actually the same terms, and then we put him into this market. He becomes a security, and people trade him. So it's exactly like operating the NASDAQ. So in order to operate a stock market, you have to deal with a huge number of transactions. On average, a loan that we put on our platform today, if they are wrong, we'll have 300 lenders. And for each one of them that is lending 100 RMB or 1,000 RMB, every month is gonna get payments. Now, we want people to lend to 3,000 people, 5,000 people. We don't want them to lend to two or three. If you're gonna lend to two or three, you don't need me. You can do it by yourself. But if you're lending money to 3,000 people, imagine the number of transactions that you're gonna have. So we're dealing with a scale issue. We need to be able to operate this in a very, very scalable way, especially that every time a lender comes into our website needs to know, how did you get to my balance? How do you keep track of all the numbers that we are doing? So in technical terms, we say that the banking industry has technology that is one to many. For our platform, it's a technology that is many to many. In fact, every green icon there could be represented by a bank. So that's what we do. The idea is we do not make money from the interest rate. That's not our revenue model. And that's what we do to keep the interest rate low. We do not decide if the lender is gonna go this direction or that direction. Some people like to lend money to women because they think they are better borrowers. Some people like to lend money to students. It's your money, you are in control of it. And when you have that feeling, you'll be tempted to lend more and more. That's how we solve it.
Thank you so much. Sounds like a very convincing product pitch. I wonder how many of the audience today will convert to your customer.
I hope all of them.
Yeah, sure. Okay, Lu, go ahead.
Okay. Because we already started actually in overseas markets, so So original name is more credit. It's called like mobile credit.
Credit
and
lending.
Then like when we're starting to explore the Chinese local market, we found like mobile credit is a little hard to pronounce and understand. So we kind of switch to MO9, and because 9 has so many meanings in Chinese, and so many successful company comes with 9, so we named them more 9.
Okay.
So what I will start here is today I just want to talk a little about transaction credit. So had a great like a PPT slide for P2P lending credits, but the credit we are dealing here is slightly different. So what we call is like transaction credit. So we will take a look at a few examples in the past how transaction credit has changed the payment space in U.S. market. And I think what I'm more interested in, and probably most people here more interested, is how can transaction credit really play a leading role, like in the mobile payment space? So I will start with that. Okay. So take a look at there's a check image. So check is the fundamental funding source in the U.S. market, but check also has its problem. Is check is based on ACH, account clearing house. So that is ACH is a non-real-time settlement system. So if I write a check to Seoul or write a check to Anna, it might take like 2 to 3 business to settle before you can actually see it from Bank of America to West Fargo, vice versa. But imagine online shopping. If like a merchant, like he's selling something, you want to buy it from him, he said, hey, I would like to buy it and I want to pay from my bank. Well, it is an option. It calls something called an electronic check, e-check. But here's the user experience. You put in all your bank account information and put that and say, hey, $50. And the merchant, what he's going to do is he's going to wait for the fund to settle in his bank account before he actually ships the goods. Okay, now 3 days later, he says, hey, money is here, I'm going to ship the goods. Now you get it. So this is a terrible user experience. So who can solve this problem? And basically what they need to do is you need to enable all the money sitting in the U.S. bank accounts. All of a sudden, they are qualified for instant online shopping. So who did it? PayPal did it. So how did PayPal do it? He pushed out a product called Instant ACH. So what exactly Instant ACH does is, when people, again, he placed an order, right? He said, okay, $50. But we know like, okay, the ACH is not real time, and the merchant and the PayPal, none of them, they can know real time from the banking system whether the money is there or not. Probably you don't have any money there. But PayPal did something. He said, okay, I will issue you an instant credit, $50. And merchant get the $50 right away. And merchant, he's happy to get the money. He's so happy that he ships the goods right away. Or not, the customer is happy. Now, consumer is happy, merchant is happy, PayPal is also happy. Why PayPal is happy? It's like there's an incentive PayPal did this product, right? Push out this product. Because in US it's different from China. China, like debit card, credit card, everything is from UnionPay. All right, but in US it's very different. Bank account funds is from ACH. And like all the credit card is from Visa, MasterCard. And so, if there is a, let's say, a $100 transaction, you go through the Visa MasterCard network, okay, you have to pay Visa MasterCard issuing bank 2.2%. All right, so PayPal charge a fee probably like 3%. Now I have to give them like 2.2. I only left like 80 cents something. What if the money is coming from the bank account? If the fund belongs to the bank account, then all of a sudden, my fee, my transaction cost is only 5 cents. Okay, I only need to give ACH 5 cents and I keep the rest $2.95. So PayPal has all the incentive to come up with this product. Then PayPal's challenge is, okay, I have to control my loss. Where's the loss coming from? There could be return. What does the return mean, right? Okay, it said, okay, I give the merchant $50 and I'm going to debit your bank account for that $50. It's called direct debit. But probably by the end of the day, it comes back, say, I'm sorry, there's not enough funds there. So basically, PayPal pushed out this product and within 2 or 3 years, he actually can manage the loss very, very well. And the money he saved from the transaction cost is far more than the loss rate he put. So it's the first time actually in the payment history, someone actually enabled all the money sitting in the bank, qualified for real-time shopping. So that's what PayPal did. That's one example, like I can see like transaction case, how transaction credit changed the payment space here. So people always under the impression like PayPal, because it's larger wallet and all the things, you have to bundle your credit card. But if you're talking about innovation, this is probably the biggest innovation he put in the American payment history. So this is how PayPal disrupted ACH network. Now if we look at a different example here, that's going to be Bill Miller. So what Bill Miller did is he disrupted the credit card issuing process. So the traditional credit card issuing process is you have to give out so much information and you have to wait so long before you can say, okay, okay, I give you $500, $10,000. I'm sorry, you cannot have too much because you have to build up your credit history. We don't have enough credit history. For the first time, BMI data actually enabled the consumer online. You don't need to have a bank account. You don't need to have a credit card. All you need is your social security number and the date of birth. Put two things there, I will let you know in 5 seconds whether you can have the instant credit for this transaction or not. So BMI data actually, he come up with this product and quickly he actually got online with Amazon.com. And it becomes so popular that PayPal actually has to buy BMI data for almost $1 billion back in 2008. There's another company, it's called Klarna. I would call it the European Billimilator. He's pretty much doing the same thing in Europe and very successful and has been like expanding into almost 20 countries in Europe. Of course, there is going to be another very successful company called Monai trying to do the same thing, so I just put it there, okay. So the last slide, what I really want to deliver message is transaction credit has done tremendous job in changing the payment space and making the payment transaction is more efficient and actually whoever did that, they made more money. That doesn't matter, it's PayPal by lowering the transaction cost. BMI data actually, he did that because he all of a sudden, BMI data becomes the issuing bank, acquiring bank, and the switch network. So he did everything by himself. So for his revenue, probably only 20% is from the traditional merchant fee revenue. His 80% revenue is actually coming from the consumer, like consumer fee, like interest, convenience fee, and all those things. So that's a phenomenon like a business model. Now I want to talk about is, in this mobile internet age, how transaction credit or how credit can make some change here. So now let's switch back to the China market. What we see here, like with Weixin and everything, like the app, tons of app with all those like mobile internet stuff coming up, and we just see tons of new payment use cases here. But what are the existing solutions that are trying to solve this payment problem or make it more efficient? It's called bundling the credit card. Probably that's the thing you hear from everywhere. Bundle your credit card and we will make the payment happen. Okay, so now we're really thinking about this problem. If we look at the research report and all those things, he said, oh, not everyone wants to bundle the credit card. And even if you bundle the credit card, the transaction conversion rate is not that high. So why would this happen, right? And all the companies so far, what are they thinking about? From which angle they're trying to solve this problem? So now let's take a look at the credit card. Credit card was invented together with point of sale equipment. So if a credit card is swiped on the POS terminal, the success rate, the conversion rate is 99.9. There's no doubt about that. Because they were bound together. They're supposed to work with each other. But now all of a sudden, it's in the mobile internet age, is you're using a credit card, I call it a credit card 1.0. Designed for the POS. You're trying to use it on the scenario. There's no such thing called point of sales or like a POS. There's no such hard equipment anymore. So what Alipay or WeChat payments, what they are essentially doing is they're coming up with a virtual POS and they're trying to accommodate this virtual POS for this traditional card 1.0. So it will work, but it will never work smoothly and work perfectly. So if we want to solve this problem completely, like what we are coming from is you need to change the card. So you can no longer use the card that comes with that hardware, the POS terminal, okay? And once you change the card, that means you change the card issuing process. You're actually changing two problems. Now there is a huge unserved user segment here. Because we see like there's so many people now have a smartphone and all those things. But only probably 10 to 20% of them actually has a credit card. And the reason the rest of people don't have a credit card, it's not because they don't have money. They don't have the money to pay for the goods. It's they don't meet the current credit card issuing process. So they were left out. So there is this huge unserved user segment. So there's definitely, if you can do something about card issuing process, you can come up with a more flexible card. It's probably not you have to submit the same information. And in return, you are not getting the probably thousands of dollars, hundreds of dollars. You probably come up with only $50, $100, but it's good enough for you to finish your first micro payments. And again, you have a chance to build up your credit history on that credit card which is issued in a different way. So that's what my point is okay, this you have an unserved user segment. Then again, because of the 70%, only 30% conversion rate, you also have a very big underserved user segment here. So those people, they don't want to bundle the credit card. The reason they don't want to bundle it, why? Because they pay too much for this credit card. They give you pretty much everything. You know, like the bank knows everything about the credit card, about themselves before you issuing card, how much I make, right? Like, how many cars I have, how many homes I have, so many information. During this payment scenario, it's not because he doesn't want to bundle the card. He doesn't want to give all the liability, all the responsibility to that $50 transaction. So if all of a sudden they have the alternative, they said, okay, I have a micropayment credit card. The card is designed for microcredit, micro-like payment here. There's no doubt in his mind he will use that card to put in his for this transaction. So basically, like the product we're coming with, we're trying to address unserved user segments, underserved user segments. So now I'm going to talk a little about what we're trying to do here. So we came up with a very different credit issuing process. It's also instant credit issuing. And we have used it towards like the gaming sector, and it has been very successful, especially with mobile games. So the user experience is very simple. You just need to enter your phone number, and as long as you confirm you are the owner of the phone, and then we can also, then there is behind the scene, of course, there is like data correction, anti-fraud, and credit vetting, and then like we finish the payments. So for the first time, we can finish is issuing the credit card, bundling the credit card, charge the credit card, finish the transaction. They're all down here, okay. So this looks simple, but there's something called a credit engine here. And I have another 10 slides of that, but you have to be one of our investors to look into those things, okay. Okay, just quick slides on, we released this product back in August 2012, so it's almost like 18 months from then. And we already look into the data is, we started with like the content provider, the game developers, and then like when we had some checkings, we found like all the channels they like to work with us, and like by the end of last year, then there's big channels like 91, 360, and all of Baidu, and not only mobile games, and also like web game, and also like some e-commerce sites that also coming work with us. So actually, for the whole year, like 2013 is. The monthly transaction volume started from like 1 million, then we finished last year at like 10 million. So here's a few examples of how exactly, where you are going to see Monai. What we call this product is really, you can buy now, pay later. And for the game, we actually even call it play now, pay later. So you can see it in the game, and like this one is like on the 360. I think this is almost like a Google Play in China. And if you download any app, there is a payment scenario there, you will see us there. And this one is actually our pilot with mobile gear, like on the e-commerce pilot. And people, they can buy something, they can dress first. If they like it, they pay us back. If they don't like it, they ship it back. So. Okay, so here's our goal. Here's where we are now. And we pretty much covered all the mobile games in China so far. And now this year, we are actually working with all the web game and terminal game, and also like e-commerce. And our goal is we are going to reach probably 50 million by the end of this year. And then like our eventual goal is by 3 years from now, we will be the largest virtual credit card issuer on mobile phone in China. Okay, thank you very much. Okay.
Thank you a lot. Please. So I think you do have a chance really to skip the many of the customers to skip the traditional 1.0 version of the classic credit card.
Yes, and basically like, what we're trying to do is first step is we work with the merchant, right, on the checkout page. Then we see, okay, if we can improve the conversion rate and increase the incremental sales, then the merchant, they will be very happy to work with us. And once the merchant put it out there, then we found, okay, this is actually, there's a big demand there. Mm-hmm. So the consumers, they really like this. And merchants are very big. They will be concerned that, hey, is this something you're going to shift user from one channel to another? But normally, all the merchants we have gone live so far, we haven't seen any one of them actually take us off. He said, hey, you increase our transaction cost, but not bringing new volumes. So.
Okay, mm-hmm. It's more about increasing the pie by capturing impulsive purchase on the spot.
Exactly.
That's very interesting. This is a really new innovation in terms of internet finance and lending credit. even credit card penetration in China is still low. 10 years ago, we were talking about because of like a credit system, so many people suspect Taobao's business is real. But today, we are seeing a GMV is bigger than Amazon plus eBay combined.
Yeah, that's true.
So nothing prevents Chinese people from spending. Then we want to really share some of the observations regarding the Chinese customers. How are they behaving differently from US market, given both of you had experience working at two different markets?
Okay. Because I'm from PayPal, so there is always one story they tell. It's back in 2005 and 2006, PayPal and eBay, they actually entered China market, and they didn't win the war with Taobao and Alipay, and eventually they withdrew from China market. So the choosing I think here is China has something US doesn't have. It's called escrow. So the escrow thing.
This product, invented by Ali, that's by opportunity. Mm-hmm. How do, based on your operating history so far, how do you observe the consumer behavior are different here in this market than in the US? Is there any difference?
Oh, then if in that sense, it's US, like he has the credit bureau. Mm-hmm. So a lot of things can be more standard. Right, so you can use Experian, Equifax, TransUnion. There's lots of things you can dump from there. But in China today, so it's not that easy because the central bank, they have some similar system, but it's not open. Mm-hmm. And so at least it's not available for e-commerce or not available for like any online transactions yet. Mm-hmm. So that will increase, it is a challenge and it is also an opportunity.
At the same time.
So to add to that, and here I have to pick my words very carefully not to make a mistake.
It's okay, we come to regulation later.
No. I wasn't talking about regulations. In the US, we say we have an honor system. It doesn't mean that China does not have an honor system. But in the US, we say there's an honor system. What does that mean? I can give you a check, and I can sign it, and I can put $100,000 in it, and give it to you, and I can disappear. You trust me enough to think that yes, when you deposit the check, money is gonna go. It does not exist in China.
Yeah, that's our culture.
So it is true, the ACH system is very inefficient and it takes 3-4 days, but the option that people have is writing a check. So without that honor system, it cannot be efficient. So that is the main difference, in my opinion, between consumers in China and consumers in the US. The society in the US is, you know, symmetric. And China is asymmetric. China is a huge country. So people in Shanghai and Beijing are very different from people in Dalian and Changsha and other places. So for you to trust a person being far away from you that you've never seen, it's not as obvious as trusting someone that, you know, you think you're very similar to him. So in my opinion, that is the big challenge that makes the big difference between the US and China.
Okay. Then how do you actually incentivize by system design in your platform to encourage people to behave towards more, you know, transparent way?
So transparency is a choice that the company makes. You can choose to be transparent or you can choose not to be transparent. It's a choice that we made, whether when we created Lending Club or when we started the Dianrong with Kevin. The idea is we will never hide information. We will never charge fees that are not clear to our borrowers and lenders. And yes, we have challenges to make sure that we are working with the right borrowers, which are exactly the same challenges as any bank in China. We have access to the same tools, we have access to the same information, and 25 to 30% of our employees are risk managers from banks. So we do exactly the same thing. The difference is that once we have that borrower, which we call an opportunity, a good quality borrower is an opportunity. Our business model is such that, okay, we found something really good. Let's give it to our lenders. We don't lend money to him. So we say that our lenders are making much more money than us, and we are happy about that. That's the difference. You stick to the business model that you do. The goal is to grow the volume. The more transactions we have, the better it is for us. We know how to do that very well, and we're gonna focus on that. We will never turn the company into becoming a lender itself.
Sure. Talking about volume, I think P2P lending has been a really hot sector, so we have to mention competition. There are several even bigger companies like on the press release already and also in some of the troublesome discussions like the online, offline, Yixin, Renren, PaiPai. How do you just compare yourself to those bigger scale and how do you think yourself is going to reach that volume, still maintain really asset-light model.
Right. So we have some products that unless you have very advanced technology, you cannot offer. Some of the examples I was showing in the slides is that when you do things, just like your business model, when you look at the small pieces, I can optimize this. For us, for example, we look at why do payments happen every month? Well, it's because of history. People always get their salary every month. That's wrong. Banks build all the system based on the monthly system. In the US, if you have a mortgage, you have companies telling you, make your payment twice a month, and I will reduce your fees, I will reduce your interest rate. We make it every day. And if you are a business in China today, and you have a third payment company, or if you have a post machine, doing payments every day is easy. So we leverage that, and we reduce the interest rates even lower, and keep the value back to our lenders. So companies that you mentioned employ 30,000 employees, employ 10,000 employees.
You have 200?
We have 200. We have 200, but the composition of those 200 is very interesting. The largest team is technology, followed by risk management. And yes, we have people that do business development and sales, but the goal is to have a team of 300 risk managers and 100 to 200 technology people. And the products that we build, we want to give them back to the financial industry to sell them for us. We are partners. So even other P2P companies are very welcome to put their business on our platform. It will cost them a lot cheaper than to operate it themselves. We are a platform company.
That sounds really logical, but although I learned from some of the successful companies like 58.com, there's no free lunch in China. Sometimes we have to be, you know, really accepting the reality. Baidu acquired Salesforce, and 58 actually is a great company despite it has thousands of hundreds of employees to really do the education, the business development with the customer. So I would concern any business when they want to scale up, although the product can be perfect, we can have 100,000 differentiations at a different level. The education to customers still sometimes take, you know, labor and time. And also, Lu, to you as well, your initial clientele was starting from gaming sector.
That's
so
right.
That's one of the most successful monetization tools remain today for mobile internet and internet also, but you're expanding to e-commerce. What do you see the potential challenges?
So when we originally designed this product, it's also it's mostly like targeting at the micro payments. So people can finish like one transaction, it's not that big amount like for a gaming transaction. So now all of a sudden the challenge is e-commerce, the average, like on mortgages, the average price is probably 70, 80 Chinese yuan, which is different from what we do. So really then-
And you will have real return and real bad debt.
No, so I think
it's- virtual goods.
Absolutely. So actually, interesting you brought that up. It's back in PayPal days, is we come with for like commerce, the virtual goods. Actually, the loss on virtual goods is a lot more than e-commerce.
Really?
Yeah, because virtual goods has a lot less information. Like you don't have shipping, you don't have like those things, right? But e-commerce has some robust data. You can put more strict like risk model on. So we're actually closely working a few pilot partners to see how that goes there.
Talking about partners, I really want to ask you, who do you view as competitors, partners? Who will be your frenemies you compete in, maybe?
So it's a difficult question. The truth is, at this stage, we don't think about that. At this stage, we really focus on building the product, building the company. But China is very different than the US. Things that happen today in the US, maybe they will happen in a couple of years in China, maybe they won't. We are staying as neutral as possible. We do see today a lot of financial institutions, including banks, very interested in what we do. The term that banks use is not internet finance, but they like to use financial technology. A bank, just like any company, has a cost and has a return. With technology, you can reduce the cost. With technology, you can create products that did not exist. So those are the people that we are attracting today. And all the buzz that is happening about internet finance in China just made us in the center of this discussion. So yes, I understand on one side, there is big internet companies. On the other side, there is banks. And currently, there is a discussion between the two. So
very intense discussion.
Very intense discussion. We are not taking sides, but our value is to take any financial market and make it more efficient. So that's
rather a friendly positioning into the ecosystem, which is evolving. So all the opportunities
absolutely
still there.
Yeah. Absolutely. I personally believe the internet should be used by everyone, and it should be for everyone. It should not be not given to banks. It should not be not given to universities. It should not be reserved by three or four companies. That's my personal belief.
It's the market
that's going to decide which direction we should go.
Yeah, exactly. However, Lu, I want to really hear your thoughts on the regulation, which is on the way, and we're still figuring ways to react to that. How it's going to impact the potential landscape for?
Yeah. So there's a lot of recently like news about how companies
heated discussion.
So that's why actually we choose gaming as the first sector we started with. So we designed our product is more like we are virtual currency, and you can exchange like using our buy our virtual currency first and exchange with like gaming items and all those things. And while those things sit in your account, you cannot withdraw it. It's not real money. You have to spend it. So now with further step is really we want to work with the regulator. Also, we're working with them very closely, like especially if you're talking about the e-commerce. Then, so thing is, you have to just start a little earlier. And also, like I think this is what this center is originally for, right? They're also trying to build up some very mature in US. It's like you can have this concept and you can slowly influence the regulators, like, okay, this is my good thing for the whole ecosystem, for the economy. So.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's exactly what we're doing too.
To demonstrate your value.
Absolutely.
Come back to the market. Okay. All the big three plus others all have ambition. They understand payment, finance, this is the foundation for transaction. This modernized the banking system. Everyone wants to get a chance. And how do you see the big three's strategy will affect you? And in future, you'll see which are the ones could potentially could be acquired, which are the services or products should be remain independent in a logical way, not only because you're running it.
Okay, so we look at this is like the big three, the current services we have, like from the payments perspective, is all like gateway payment services. So they just connect the consumer merchant and the bank and all those things. Really, there is no tradition in taking the risk in doing the payments, right? And also, why are they starting to do that based on the experience from PayPal? Is they trying to do something like this, but eventually they end up buying a company like Billimeter. So that's definitely something we're looking for that is also happening in China. Of course, we saw that happens a lot more frequently these days, though.
So. My goodness, yeah. Wall Street Journal journalists even lost track on the deals happening every day. On a quarterly basis, they're writing billion-dollar checks.
Yeah.
So we'll expect.
Okay.
So if I may, just to add to that point, a lot of people do not remember when Lending Club started. We started inside of Facebook, and we were super excited. Facebook has 60 million users. We're going to convert half of them. We're going to be a successful company. I know Facebook people are here in the room. That was a disaster for us. Social networks, the internet, does not dictate how everything is going to be run. It took us a year to find out that viral effect does not work if you're a borrower. If I'm borrowing money, the last thing I want you to know, if you're my friend, that I'm borrowing money. Finance is a private matter. So innovation by internet companies is good, and it made a lot of things easy, but it's not the solution for everything we like to modernize today. And I think banking and financial industry could be one of them.